So we're already at week three of our Advent series, which means that after today, there's only one more Sunday before Christmas. That excites me. Over the last few weeks, we've been looking at the Christmas story, starting with Mary and the announcement that she was going to have a baby, God's son. And then last week, Robbie shared Joseph's story and looked at his reaction and the confirmation. This week, we're going to spend some time looking at the journey and how that is relevant to us today. So let's begin and hear today's reading read from Luke chapter 2, 1 to 7. And this morning, Morig will read that to us.
The reading today is taken from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7 in the Amplified Version. Jesus' birth in Bethlehem. Now in those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Caesar Augustus that all the inhabited world, the Roman Empire, should be registered in a census. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to register for the census, each to his own city. So Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, in order to register with Mary, who was betrothed to him and was with child. While they were there in Bethlehem, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her son, her firstborn, and she wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no private room for them in the inn. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Morig. So in preparing for a journey, we would make sure that the car was full of fuel, check the tyres, the oil, make sure that there's enough skoosh for the windscreen before setting off on an 80-mile journey, possibly deciding where's a good place to stop for coffee on the way. For Mary and Joseph, it was indeed very, very different. Caesar Augustus, the Roman emperor, had given an order that the names of all the people had to be listed in the record books. Everyone had to go to their hometown to be listed. Joseph had to leave Nazareth in Galilee and go to Bethlehem in Judah. You see, long ago, Bethlehem had been King David's home. And I'm sure you remember the story about David and Goliath. David grew and eventually became king, and we can read about him in the Old Testament. Joseph went there because he was from David's family. He was a descendant. And Mary, engaged to Joseph, travelled with him. And as we understand, she was very heavily pregnant at the time. The journey to Bethlehem was about 80 miles. For us, that would be Inverness to Aberdeen, not by road, but as the crow flies. Mary and Joseph would not have travelled on roads like we do, but they would have been on dirty and rocky roads. Mary's form of transport would have possibly been a donkey or a wooden cart with the donkey. And we can presume that Joseph would have walked alongside her, guiding the way. The journey would have taken them at least 4 days. And today we could travel that distance in less than 2 hours. You can imagine all the stops that they had to make along the way, especially with Mary having an almost full-term baby, leaning on her bladder. Yes, she was human. And I can still remember carrying my boys and the amount of times I had to get up through the night and the pillows that surrounded me. They would have had to rest, but where? On the side of the road? They would have had to eat. Did they start a fire to cook something? There would have been no drive-through McDonald's or Starbucks. How did they keep their food fresh, and how much water did they carry with them? How many changes of clothes did they bring along with them? Where did they wash up? Where did they even change their clothes? Perhaps that's my female brain thinking about all the practical things that would have been needed. We don't know all the answers to these, but I think you can get the picture that it wasn't quite like the children's song Little Donkey describes. It would have been a very difficult journey. So possibly 4 long days later, they arrive in Bethlehem. And if you have ever taken part in a nativity play or watched one, you will be fully aware of what happens next.
All booked up, sorry.
We don't need much.
What part of I'm all booked up did you not understand? I have no room for you in my inn.
Please. We've been walking for days.
Do you think you are the first person to pound on my door at this hour of the night looking for a room?
There has to be something. A closet, perhaps.
You can keep asking the same question. I'm going to give you the same answer.
Why? What are you doing up? You need to rest now. We won't be any trouble. And I'll pay you whatever you want. Please.
I'm sorry. No vacancies.
God'll provide.
Hey. Give me a minute.
I remember having to play an innkeeper once and say, sorry, no room here, and shut the door, well, my pretend door. And although we talk about no room, my understanding is that the Greek word here translated as inn is kataluma, I hope I pronounced that correctly, which means a place of rest, usually a guest room. Joseph was going back to his hometown, and possibly it meant that there was no room because someone else was in the guest room. There were so many other family members coming home to Bethlehem for the census. No one had space for them. And since the guest room was full, they were offered the stable. And I suppose after travelling all that way, somewhere sheltered like that would have been appreciated. The bottom line is, we don't actually know, but given what we have read in Luke chapter 2 and the context and the culture at the time, we can have a very good understanding. The journey would have been difficult, but what a reward at the end of it, Jesus. Verse 6 and 7, while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. This journey is like a step in a bigger journey. You see, the real journey, it begins in Genesis. Yes, Jesus was right there in the Old Testament too. And I believe that one God eternally exists in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that these three are one God, co-equal, co-eternal, having exactly the same nature and attributes and worthy of precisely the same worship, confidence, and obedience. And as the hymn writer puts it, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Jesus was there in the beginning. He came to earth as a baby, and we celebrate and remember that at Christmas time. But the journey continues, and Jesus lived among us. And you can read about that and the many miracles that Jesus performed and the people that he helped in the first four books of the New Testament. Then, as we remember, every Easter, Jesus went on, didn't he? And he suffered and he cruelly died on the cross for you and for me, to pay the price for all the wrongs that we have done and that we will do. The journey goes on, and he rose again on the third day. And then after some time with his closest friends, he ascended to heaven, where one day, if we follow Jesus, we will be with him in our new healthy bodies, where the Bible says there will be no more tears. And that excites me. I don't know about you, but this earthly journey can be very, very hard some days. And there certainly has been many difficult days in 2020, many 2020 tears. There's been a lot of talk, oh, well, we're all in the same boat. But, you know, this year, I really don't think that we are. We have all got differing challenges and difficulties. Some of us have lost loved ones during this difficult year. Some lost jobs, some feeling lonely and isolated, some suffering with differing illnesses, and I could go on and on. The storm of 2020 has affected us all differently, but one thing is very certain, it has affected us all. This Christmas, as we reflect on the journey to Jesus' birth and look at our own journey, can I encourage you to think about inviting Jesus to journey with you? It's a personal thing. Jesus meets us where we are, and we are all at differing stages. I heard it once said that Jesus is a gentleman. He waits for an invitation, and he's longing for that personal invitation from each of us, inviting him to come and journey with us. My boys have all gone through Boys Brigade, and if you know anything about BBs, you will have heard or know the hymn, Will Your Anchor Hold? The chorus goes, we have an anchor that keeps the soul, steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Saviour's love. Through the storms on life's journey, will you let Jesus be that anchor? He is indeed steadfast and sure. He cannot be moved. He is that firm foundation that we can build our lives upon. I heard a great quote the other day from Brian Houston, who is a pastor in Australia of one of the biggest global churches. He said, a healthy well-being can only be built on a healthy foundation. And in a day where health and well-being is high on the social agenda, can I encourage you to think about your foundation? We all know that if there's a problem with the foundation of a house, there are serious issues and consequences for the building. Likewise, and how more important is life? How is your foundation this morning? Jesus, Emmanuel, he is a firm foundation. To quote another hymn, on Christ the solid rock we can stand, because all other ground is sinking sand. So we have looked at the journey to Bethlehem and in turn been encouraged to look at our own journey. Where are we going? And who are we going to bring with us? This Christmas series is entitled Noel, which means birth in Latin, the birth of Jesus. This Christmas, may you know that new life that Jesus can offer, And if you have already invited Jesus to journey with you, may you know a deeper relationship with him as you keep a daily check on your foundation, reading your Bible and keeping close to him in prayer. Chris Tomlin wrote a Christmas song called Noel, and it features Lauren Daigle, however you pronounce her surname. And it's a beautiful song inviting the listener to come and to see what God has done. The story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us. And in the darkness of 2020, we can know that amazing hope, the amazing love, the light of Jesus. This song was put together with video footage from the Nativity story, and it goes through the journey that we've looked at today and that we looked at over the last few weeks. Let's take some time now to listen, to watch, and to reflect on this story of amazing love.
Love incarnate, love divine. Star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No.
To raise us from the grave.